silkworm. Bildad, one of Job's friends, compares people to worms. In Job 25 verse 6, he says, "How much less a man who is a maggot and a son of man who is a worm?" One of the most known worms, which is also a larva or caterpillar, is the silkworm. This larva hatches from the eggs laid by the silkworm moth. Its Latin name, Bombyx mori, means the worm of the mulberry tree. The obvious reason for its name is mulberry tree leaves is its main dietary intake. Can you remember all the phases of the life cycle of a silkworm? Let us revise. The adult female silkworm moth, which cannot fly nor eat, looks for a partner. She excretes pheromones to lure a male for mating. After mating, she lays many thousands of tiny eggs and then dies. After the two-week breeding time, the larvae hatch as small worms and start eating. This is the part where all those tiny worms will keep you extremely busy, continuously picking mulberry leaves for them to eat. They also shed their skins more than twice and become lighter in color as they grow bigger. Tiny horns on the worm indicate adulthood. They are very fragile, harmless, and cannot flee from danger. These aspects make them very popular for school and class projects, or as pets for children. When the larva is fully grown, it starts to spin a cocoon. This is where the fun usually begins. When you place the worm on top of a shape cut from a carton, like a heart or a star, the worm will cover the entire shape with golden or white silk threads. If the worm only ate leaves from the white mulberry tree, the silk will be white. However, spinach leaves, lettuce, or purple mulberry tree leaves will make the silk golden yellow. When the worm encloses itself in silk, the round little house is called a cocoon. One cocoon has around 900 meters, almost a kilometer, of silk threads. The larva changes inside the cocoon into a papilla, which will eventually change into a moth. In the warmer tropical parts of the world, the life cycle can repeat itself more than once a year. But in South Africa, the cocoon will stay closed until it becomes warmer in spring and the mulberry trees grow new leaves. The moths climb out of their cocoons, mate, lay eggs, and within 2 weeks hatch new tiny silkworms, which can be fed with mulberry leaves. You can even start your own silk factory. The breeding of silkworms for the production of silk has been a practice in China for over 5,000 years. Later, countries like Korea, Japan, India, and Russia also adopted the trade. Silkworm cocoons are a main source of the world's silk. Silk production forms part of the textile and clothing industry. Silkworms are no longer found in their natural habitat because of controlled breeding by humans. They are now completely reliant on people for protection and survival. There is a legend about a young Chinese empress. Her name was Lei Su. She sat under a mulberry tree when a silkworm cocoon fell in her teacup. She began pulling the silk apart and wrapped it around her finger. It felt soft and warm, and she realized that it can be used for weaving material. This incident is believed to be the beginning of the silk industry. In the New Testament, we read about a woman who had her own clothing factory. She helped others by making clothes for them and selling clothes for an income. In Acts 9, verse 36 to 40, there was a woman named Tabitha. Her name can also be translated as Dorcas. She lived in Joppa, did many good works and gave to the poor. She fell ill and died. Her friends washed her body and put her in the upper room of the house. Lydda was near Joppa, and they heard that Peter was close to that area. They sent two men to Peter and begged him to come to the house of Dorcas. Peter went with them, and when they reached Dorcas's house, the widows showed him the tunics and garments Dorcas had made when she was still alive. Peter sent everyone outside, knelt, and prayed to God. Then he turned to her body and said, "Tabitha, arise." She opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up. Maybe it was important to let this silkworm woman live, because she understood what Jesus wanted us to do for others. Jesus reminds us to do good to the poor and needy in Matthew 25. He says, "For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these my brethren, you did it to me." Remember, when you care for someone in need, you are also like a silkworm that encloses others with a cocoon of Jesus' love.